that we need guidance. You know, science can't guide us alone. And we set out to develop this Anjase Aki Summit on Climate Change. And this is an open access publication where we were allowed to document in the lodge with cameras in that good way that we were mentioning. And there's some neat outcomes. So next slide, please. And, you know, the elders were talking for 4 days, elders and knowledge keepers from across the Americas, and saying, you know, that the human values caused by colonization of greed, arrogance, anger, dominance, selfishness, you know, disrespect, ignorance, those are the things that cause the behaviors, the extraction, pollution, war, violence that lead to the impacts of climate change, biodiversity loss, water pollution, and other environmental impacts. And for me, as a Western trained scientist, you know, it turns the whole thing on your head. We're looking at climate change as the cause. And the elders are saying, no. Climate change is the symptom. The cause is us and the values that we have. And we need to have, as the title of the paper says, and Elder Kershane said, a change of heart. That was the real takeaway of this gathering and one of the important findings that is articulated in this paper. Next slide, please. And, you know, looking at the problems, the traditional knowledges and Indigenous-led solutions can really kind of help to ameliorate those things. And so spirit, ceremony, as was mentioned by Brett, language, identities, all these things are really, really important when we think about Indigenous knowledge and how they create solutions that that challenge and deal with the problems that, that we're talking about with respect to climate change. Next slide, please. And so thinking this kind of two-eyed seeing approach with elders and knowledge keepers and scientists, we started thinking about the Climate Atlas of Canada. This is an online tool, climateatlas.ca. It's got the best available climate model data in it. You can go into this tool and actually look at any jurisdiction in Canada and the future climate projections for those areas. So we're with the National Capital Commission tonight. You can click right into Ottawa, click right into the region, look at climate variables and see the change that is projected for your location, but the entire country at the same time. So it's quite an innovative tool. Next slide, please. We launched it in 2018 with then Minister of Environment, Catherine McKenna. There was huge media impact, tons of users, and it's one of the main tools used for applied adaptation in this country. Next slide, please. We've launched reports like heat waves and health about heat waves based on these data. Next slide, please. And you can see just this was out in 2018, you know, talking about the heat waves that we were going to see in the future, and they're knocking at our door now. You know, we're going to have plus 20 or plus 35 or 37 on Sunday here in Winnipeg. It's just unfathomable that these temperatures are happening year after year after year. And this is what we need to prepare for. The data can help us one version of kind of understanding this. Next slide, please. And so we're doing applied planning at the Prairie Climate Center with communities like the city of Selkirk, developing adaptation strategies linked to these data and community priorities and community knowledge. Next slide, please. And this is kind of what this looks like, risk assessment and prioritization of risks so that people in these communities can actually figure out what municipal services might be affected, who might be responsible for it. And we're making films about the process. So you can actually go watch the film on the Climate Atlas about the Selkirk journey of developing this model for adaptation. You can look at their adaptation plan. It's an award-winning adaptation plan. Next slide, please. I'm going to hand it back to Brett.
Thanks, Ian. So Indigenous knowledge has typically been relegated to past tense kind of in past tense area, something that isn't current. But also I've heard people refer to our knowledges as not evidence-based and, you know, the assumptions made. But civilizations do not exist in places for tens of thousands of years just by assumption. Our people had a way to peer review our work and understanding of the world. We had people who were the equivalent of biologists, environmentalists, and people who could understand the weather. And so there, how do we get in touch with these knowledges in a way that can be expressed the way that we tell that we share our stories? And one of the important methods of doing that we found with the work we're doing is through film. Film in a good way allows us so many avenues of following OCAP principles while also maintaining very good relationships and giving something that's easier for elders to review when they look over things that they've shared. They can actually look at the film and tell us if they want something in there or that's not what they meant. You have to include this sentence before they get to review these things. So we have a library of amazing content that people can access now. And this kind of led in, doing all of this work started to lead us towards creating a section that is just dedicated to Indigenous knowledges. Next slide, please. So this is where we wanted to go. We wanted to provide the same kind of data for Indigenous communities to use in their planning, but at the same time, learning from them and having a place for them to share the knowledges that they have about adaptation on the land that they've used for thousands of years, because this would benefit us in both research now and going forward in planning. And so we developed the Indigenous Knowledges section of the Climate Atlas of Canada, and it uses all of the same data that you can access, but for now it's done on in the communities themselves, and you'll see more about that in the upcoming video. But it was really important for us, guided by the elders, guided by the youth, and guided by ceremony, to create this section, because it allowed us to really showcase what Indigenous knowledges are. Next slide, please. So when it came time to release this content, it was really important for us to have the matriarchs from the communities launch this in a very good way, because the matriarchs are the ones who really lead our people, and they're the strength of the nations in my perspective, and in the cultures of our people on this land. It was really important for us to acknowledge that. And we had three amazing thinkers, leaders from the country. We had Cassidy Caron, Kluani Adamic, and Sila Wakluche. They're phenomenal people who are at the forefront of leading this narrative around climate change at the higher levels, at the highest levels. And so this is something that was key for us to acknowledge that, and important for us to show that we want to do this thing as best as we can so that we can continue this work into the future. And I don't know if you wanted to add anything else before we go.
You can see that the full launch is available on the Climate Atlas on the main page. And so it's a 90-minute session hearing from these like very thought-provoking speakers. Cassidy Caron is the president of the Métis Nation National Council. Kluani Adamic is the Yukon Regional Chief and Lead for Climate Change for AFN. And Sila Wakluche got co-nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize with Al Gore, linking climate change and human rights. And so really, really incredible speakers. And you can check that out as well. And maybe next slide, because I think we're queuing up the video. So we're going to show you a video of the Indigenous Climate Atlas. It's a short video, and it gives you a real sense of what's in there and what's possible with the tools that have been kind of co-created, co-designed with communities. So thank you very much. And yeah.
Simgiget, Sigamahana, Gantkubu Wilsuch. Hetkum Sket, why a Luxin Sit will tell Huxley whip good canoe will so wit we. Hi, my name is Hetkum Sket. I'm also known as Brett Hewson.
And I'm Ian Morrow. I'm the executive director of the Prairie Climate Center here at the University of Winnipeg on Treaty One territory in the homeland of the Métis Nation.
And we just wanted to take you through the Indigenous Knowledges section of the Climate Atlas. So I just wanted to preface this with why we use the term Indigenous, and it's more to be inclusive, not to label the peoples, but to be inclusive of the many different nations and peoples who live on the in this country and who are from these lands. And we wanted to show you the Indigenous Knowledges and Climate Change section, and this talks about why it's important to include Indigenous Knowledges in climate change research, what colonialism has done to cause climate change, and it provides a little background about what it's important to have this section here on the Climate Atlas. And we've worked with a distinctions-based approach, so we have First Nations, Inuit, and Métis sections. So if we jump into the First Nations section, we see that at the top there's a video that talks about the National Climate Gathering with the Assembly of First Nations. It was an amazing gathering, a lot of great minds gathered. And then you look at the Anjistay Aki Initiative and climate change. And this one is really important for us because it honors the ideas and the teachings of the late Elder Dave Cushane, who was really instrumental in connecting us with the youth, elders, and people who pushed this idea forward and helped us accomplish this section.
And when we kind of click out of the First Nations section, we see that the Inuit are here, and I've worked extensively with Inuit communities across Inuit Nunangat. And when we jump in, we've got a video of Silawat Kluche, you know, the instrumental in linking climate change and human rights, her book, The Right to Be Cold. We've asked permission from ITK, Inuit Tepirit Katanami, to have their national Inuit climate change strategy here. Voices from Elder Joanesi Karpik and the interaction with youth, lots of important resources. The film that I made with Zacharias Kunuk, Inuit Knowledge and Climate Change, so bringing that northern perspective to the Atlas. And here in the homeland of the Métis Nation, although I'm not Indigenous myself, my wife and my children are. They come from intergenerational Métis families, and it was quite an honor. We worked with filmmaker Chris Gaudry, Métis filmmaker Chris Gaudry, and he made these Métis videos, Métis communities, the, you know, importance of solar, wildland firefighters, you know, the traditional knowledge of the forest and how to protect communities. There's lots of great content in here, and it is kind of complemented with a series of Indigenous climate change maps.
And when I created the icon that we use for the Indigenous section, I wanted something that encompassed the land itself, because that's actually what creates the culture of the lands, is the land itself. And if you look to the left side of the map, you see the icon there. And when you click on the icon, you can break it down into First Nations, Inuit, and Métis projects and communities. And this is something that is really important for us, because you can access the information from your community, and more importantly, you can access videos and documentaries from across the country that relate to Indigenous knowledges.
And so when we click on First Nations, for example, this is every single First Nations reserve community, 634 communities, literally from coast to coast to coast. And you've got sliders here, which is less and more climate change in different time periods. And so if we jump forward to the 2051 to 2080 time period, we're looking at, you know, that kind of extreme kind of climate change moving forward. And every single community now has data. And if we look at, you know, the Treaty 1 territory here where we are, if we go to, say, for example, Long Plain, we're looking at the number of plus 30 days in that high carbon far future. And you can see that there's going to be a jump of almost 40 plus 30 days in this location. And any community in any region of the country across these diverse Indigenous territories can go and get this data now. As Brett mentioned, it's distinctions based. So if we go to Inuit communities and we back the map out, we can see all of the Inuit communities. And this is the first time that this kind of data has ever been made available for Indigenous peoples of this country they call Canada. And if we click in and we start to look at, you know, some of these Arctic communities, I've spent a lot of time up in Iqaluit and Pangnirtung. And if we go to cold weather, there's different variables. So if we look at the loss of the cold, say minus 30 days in a place like Iqaluit, we've got, you know, the historical baseline about 50 minus 30 days, and that's going to drop to 6. We're going to lose almost 50 minus 30 days. And that's an example of the change that's coming to the Arctic. And that's an example of why a map like this is so powerful in terms of helping communities think forward, plan. And when we go into the final section, Métis projects, we've got projects that the Métis National Council with their governing members have helped to kind of plot across the map that looks at the different initiatives that the Métis communities and leadership of this country have been, you know, developing for climate solutions. And so it's a pretty important tool that is now available.
And one thing I just want people to remember is this is a place we want to be inclusive for everybody. So if you see your community name isn't what you think it should be, you let us know and we can change that to what it's supposed to be. And also just to remember that we're not trying to label anyone here. This is about making information and resources and research and data available for you and your community, but more importantly also to share your knowledge with everyone else, so that we have a place where we can bring science and Indigenous knowledges together in a good way.
Wow, thank you so much, Ian and Brett. That was a wonderful presentation, given us lots of things to look forward to in conversation. Maybe just a quick question. How much uptake are you having with this Prairie Climate Atlas, and how are you continuing to promote it so that this information gets out to the world?
Yeah, well, when we launched it, Brett and I were on syndicated radio across the country. There was an incredible amount of news, national news. It was a massive, massive launch. And the Atlas in and of itself, before it was indigenized in a sense, was already one of the main tools being used by Canadians for applied adaptation and climate information. So we already had a pretty significant audience, and it's just grown, and the interest in it. And, you know, it just shows to the power of being inclusive and ensuring that lots of people are included in the design of things, so that you build them in a way that speaks to the needs of a diversity of people. So I think it's worked well in that regard. I don't know, Brett might have any final comments. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Yeah, no, I've received a lot of really great feedback from a lot of the First Nation communities that I've been presenting to and speaking with, both with the Prairie Climate Center as well as on my own as an author. Like I kind of work both ways. I've been taking to lectures for my books, but they also know about the Climate Atlas, and there's a lot of positive feedback, a lot of amazing suggestions that we're getting. And again, we're a pretty small team, so we're trying to the best we can to not only keep it running in the best operational form that we can, but also, you know, hopefully include a lot of these suggestions in the future going forward. Our plan is to keep evolving it in a way that a lot of the people who are making suggestions can get the information and tools that they need. But a lot of them love the idea of doing this development for the research for their communities, because you're actually finding funding opportunities now that require communities to actually include some projections. So this tool allows them to do that, allows them to seek out that funding that they couldn't get before, because now they have a place to look for projections from their own community. So it's been really great with that regard.
Fantastic. So thanks very much. We'll come back to you a little bit later. We're going to continue and speak with the other members of our panel tonight. I did also just want to take a moment to say, I think we had some technical difficulties at the beginning of the broadcast on the English channel, but just to say we're here tonight at the Urbanism Lab talking about climate change and Indigenous knowledge. We're here with Brett Hewson and Ian Morrow, who you just heard from, and in the rest of the evening we're going to be speaking with Pinnock, member of Kitigan Zibi Anishinaabeg here in the National Capital Region, and as well Brenda Ojik, also from Kitigan Zibi. Thanks for your patience as we work through those technical challenges. I think we're all good now. I did want to have a bit of a conversation with you, Pinnock, about some of the things that you've brought tonight. We see on the stage some snowshoes, cradle board, fur, a small canoe. What can you tell us about some of these, about yourself and about the items you brought to share with us this evening?
All the items you see here are things that I sort of dabble with. I'm from Kitigan Zibi, and I was raised in a community that where people are still doing these things. So from the school of life, I kind of picked up on it. It was our way of teaching. It was the 3L system, you know, look, listen, and learn. And then being in a real poor community, didn't have that much toys to play with, so I played with things that were practical for our survival and stuff. And so I got to learn a few things that pertain to my culture, and I really enjoyed doing it. And I'm most thankful to the community that taught me all these things. So I'm definitely not self-taught. I was taught by a lot of different members within a community itself. It's a thing I'm always grateful for.
Wonderful. Well, we understand you have a sort of a specialty in birch bark canoes. What can you tell us about what you learned to make birch bark canoes? You know, when were you taught? Who taught you? How did you get those skills?
I don't know. It's just something that I'm very proud of, the birch bark canoe. When I started working on it, I've seen people doing it all my life and stuff. I've personally been doing it for about 30 years actively now, but I was raised with people seeing my grandfather, and I seen different people making canoes. And I always appreciated the canoe, of course, but more the selection of the material and the intelligence that went into the design of it. And its simplicity, it's ingenious the way these things come together. If we had the time, I would explain this all to you, but it's just something that I wish to make people aware of our culture. We have a very rich culture, and I like people to be aware of it, that we invented these things. These are not from a German-French designer, you know, it's a North American native design. And I really appreciate the workmanship and the intelligence that went into it. It gives me pride in my ancestors, and in turn gives me pride in myself, because true life, I went to school and stuff for a while, and everything I learned there was all negative about natives. Practically non-existent, you know, we're just a pain sometimes, you know. So when you do something that pertains to your culture, because culture is who you are, and when you start doing something that pertains to your own culture, you start to appreciate your people and yourself more. But it's good to learn about other cultures as well, because we're all on this planet together, you know. And we're talking about climate change and stuff, we're all guilty. It's not just one nation, we're all guilty of that, you know. And there is change that we could do if we can get out of our denial, you know, and get into, you know, thinking of ways that we can work it out so that we have a better environment to live in again. My ancestors were the masters of keeping the balance of nature, because we were only part of nature. We didn't try to run it, we didn't own it, we were just part of it. So they had that mentality that they had respect for everything around them. So they had the respect for the land, they had respect for the animals, everything, the thing. Today, if we had that same one word, respect, we'd have a different environment to live in. So I think one way we could kind of help that out would be to educate people. Tell them, you know, that there is ways we can reverse this. And the scientists know it, the biologists know it, all the people know it. The governments don't accept it because it's money involved in there. So if we would enlist these things, it'd be a cutback on the economy and stuff. And the economy right now is the main factor. That's all people worry about. You know, so we destroy environment, and we don't really mind.
Well, part of the advantage of being here tonight is part of that education process for all of us that are here and listening online. What could you, just going back to canoes for a moment, what could you tell us about, you know, how to build a canoe?
How to build a canoe?
Mm-hmm. And then maybe, yeah, anyway, we'll okay. Start there.
I can give you a quick version of it.
Sure.
Actually, the hardest part of building a canoe is not the canoe itself. It's the gathering of the material that's hard today. And there's a few factors involved with that. There's the climate change, of course, but the main factor for the birch bark, it's the lumbering companies that are overcutting the trees. We are mismanaging the forestry very, very badly. They're doing clear cuts there now, replanting trees that don't belong there. Don't leave big trees to protect the little trees. So management is very, very bad for that thing. But the canoe building itself is very simple. You just go to a bush, you come find a nice tree, if you can find one, and you remove the bark off it. When you're doing small items like the canoe, birch, wigwams, baskets and stuff, we don't actually harm the tree. We're just taking out the outer bark, and the inner bark protects the trees. So we're not going out into the land and destroying trees. And if we make a canoe, we take the bark, we take the tree down, because we don't want to lose our bark. So we take the one piece. If you're making a 15-foot canoe, you want a 16, 17-foot piece of bark. There's no way you're going to be able to take that off the tree. So we take the tree down. But we don't take the tree down after we've checked for the quality of the bark. Today, that's another factor that comes into play. Bark is a very nice material to work with. If you can get quality bark, it's like a piece of rubber. You can play with that any which way you want. That's what they have quality. Today, we haven't got that quality, though. I talked to my uncle when I was working with him, how the canoe handled in rough waters. They used to hit rocks from coming down the rapids, because they didn't portage. They went down the rapids and stuff and hit rocks and things. They didn't harm the bark. The bark would be like the Kevlar canoe of today would pop in, break ribs on the interior. But since there's no nails, screw, or glue using these things, I can remove all the ribs in this thing. I can take everything out of it. I can just pull this out. There's your rib. All the sheeting within a canoe can come apart. It's in the design of it. That's why I say it's very quite ingenious the way they did these things. There's no, It's only pressure held, you know, so you think about it. It's quite ingenious. When they put the ribs and you put them at an angle, from the ends work towards the middle. At this point, they're very, very secure. But the bark's going to stretch. You come back a few hours later, the next day, you tap a little bit more, let the bark stretch some more, and eventually get them in place. Once they're in the place the way they should be, the pressure of the bark against the ribs holds everything together. So I think that's quite an ingenious way of doing things, you know. And they got these, and these things were made without metal tools. We had no metal in this part of the country. We had bone and stone tools, which we used. So all you got to do is separate the fibers. So the selection of the material is very ingenious as well, because they only use four materials. For most of the needs that we had as an Algonquin nation, four trees gave us what all the things that we needed. There's a birch tree, gave us the bark to make our motor transportation, our shelters, our cooking pots. Everything was made out of birch bark. That was the thing we need. Cedar, we use a lot of. For all the interior of the canoe, cedar. It's a material that lasts us for a long time, as the bark does as well. Then we use the spruce. The spruce we needed for the spruce gum to prevent water from coming to the thing. And the roots. The roots are the only thing that holds this canoe together. It's a spruce root. The rest, it's all pressure held. And we use the root to sew up our things and everything. Then we got the ash. Ash wood we use for the thwarts in the canoe. But also ash wood we use a lot of for snowshoe frames, drum rounds, cradle boards, paddles. You know, and we can make baskets. We pound it. We can make baskets out of it. So we had multiple uses for the ash wood. So there's only four species of trees. Of all the trees that we have in this area, we use only four. So it was, you know, how long did it take them to come about finding these four, you know? I have no input into canoe. Everything I do to canoe, I try and do this as traditionally as I can. I don't use stone and bone, because as natives, we always adapted well to the environment we lived in. So by using a metal tool as a knife, I'm adapting to the environment I'm living in today, you know? So I said I was native. I didn't say I was exactly all stupid and stuff, you know. So anyway, it's a thing that I'm very proud of.
So we understand that sometimes you're finding you need to travel farther to find some of these materials. Why is that?
One of the main reasons is for the overcutting of trees again, the forestry business, you know. Also, I don't know. It's mostly the forestry. I gotta blame it on that, you know, because there's a lot of overcutting, especially from the area I'm from. This area we're here, well, above Ottawa and above, was prime land for birch. The climate was right and the soil was right. So all the East Coast nations depended on birch bark. Even if you didn't have it in their territory, we did a lot of trading in the days. So we'd trade bark for caribou, whatever, you know. So all the nations used a lot of birch bark. And we had the prime land for it. Oftentimes they say the Algonquins made the best canoes. I like to believe that, but I think it's just because we had the best material to make them with, you know, and they had a good selection of it. So I don't know, it's just...
I suppose that's your comparative advantage, just to have the best materials in this area.
That's what it is. What happened is I got spoiled. Because in the 60s, I was able to go into the bush. Yeah, late 50s, I used to go with my father, and then in the 60s, we'd go in the bush, and you'd return material, you'd come back with material, and the quality was better. Now today, I go out in the bush, I go for a couple of days, and I don't find bark for canoes, because you can't find it. It takes a certain type of tree to do it. It's got to be a straight tree, no knots on it. It's got to be pliable. Today, you take a piece of bark, and the trees are dying alive. If you go to see a tree stand of birch, look at the tops, you see them all darkened. If the trees are darkened on the top because there's kind of burning lake, it affects the bark as well. So you remove a piece of bark and you play with it, and it cracks. So it's too brittle, so we don't use it. So it's a lot of things that go into finding the material. It's the most difficult part of building a canoe, just to find the material.
Yeah. And you've mentioned ash trees as well. To what extent is that part of your canoe building and other and the other kinds of things that you make, and I'm trying to draw a link as well with the emerald ash borer. Is that something that you encounter, or you're seeing effects of that?
It's moving up.
Okay.
It hasn't hit the region that bad yet, but in this area here, it did. They're getting rid of all the trees and stuff because of that borer, but it hasn't been bad in our area yet. What's bad again is the lumbering company. Before ash wood was considered like a scrap wood. Nobody harvested it. They weren't using it. And then nowadays they take it for, people are starting to use it for cabinets and flooring and different things. Before you never used that. You use all this oak, maple, you know, beech and stuff like that. So today the ash wood is being cut a lot. And today they change method of doing things. Now they just make fiberboard. So they take all kinds of trees and they just chip it down to make sawdust and they glue it together again. Then they make the boards. So that's why they get the clear cuts. They cut the whole territory out. You know, it's not like before you would go for a certain type of tree and you leave all the other trees there. So the environment stayed the same. Today they're changing everything, changing the soil. They change the landscape is changing because the trees are all being changed. The natural growth that belongs there is not there. They cut all the maple, all the hardwood out, and they plant pine and something else there. So what they do is they scrape all the ground, push all the sand in one place, they burn all the stumps and stuff, or leave it just rot there, and then they plant pine and everything around. The natural growth comes back. A few years later, they send brush cutters in there to cut all the natural trees and leave their trees to grow, because they want to be able to produce, reproduce them in a few years, take them out again. So that takes away from the soil. You're changing the soil content altogether. Also, it takes away from the animals. The animals have no protection. The moose has no place to hide. There's no trees. You've got these one little couple of pines. They don't eat pine. They don't like eating pine. So you've got food for a while. When the new growth comes up, they can eat for a while. But when the snow's covered, they have no food anymore. So the moose are moves out. All the animals are affected. The climate change is affecting everybody, including people. I think we're getting crazier every day, you know. But it's we'll blame it on that, too. We'll blame it on climate change. But I've noticed climate change for a long time, a few years now, because I used to go in the bush often. I've spent most of my life in the bush. And temperature changed, that snow change, the animals change. Because there's places in the country in our province where the deer weren't going there because it was too cold for them, too much snow, too cold. In about the 60s, I started noticing deer tracks in the southern end of the park where I have my trap line. And then a couple of years later, they were past my trap line, and now they're right through the park because of the warming. They can survive there. And we never had wild turkeys here. I see wild turkeys in northern upper state New York, and then I see them in Ontario, but I never seen turkeys in my part of the country. Now we have them there year round. So there is a big change, and now it's getting more extreme. It's happening like crazy. You know, it's not hard to see. Just turn on the TV and you'll see all kind of crazy things happening in the earth. We're having forest fires in the middle of winter, you know, flooding, freezing places, you know, where it's supposed to be balmy, it's freezing. Where it's freezing, it's hot. It's different.
I think we can draw some links with the map that Brett and Ian were showing us, which showed exactly the red effects that are happening with climate change. What are some of the specific impacts that climate change is having on your community in total? And
the community itself? Mm-hmm. I don't know. It impacts everybody. It impacts us like everybody else. We're not, just because we're native doesn't mean that we're different in any way. We've been assimilated so much, we're all in the same bucket here, you know. So whatever goes, you're going through, we're going through as well. You know, it's not, it didn't affect us really hard. It affected me because I work with birch bark. I noticed that. But if I wasn't working with birch bark, it wouldn't affect me any more than it affects you. You know, you don't like it. You realize there's something wrong here. But you know, we still go on. But it bothers me because I can't get good birch bark. Take this thing, for example. This here is a nice piece of bark. Today I'm getting a lot of this here. It's bubbling up. There's a lot of oil content in the bark. That's what makes it so good for a canoe. It's waterproof, it repels the water. So it'll never get wet or anything. But the heat makes this thing bubble up, and then I get air bubbles into it. So it makes an awful looking canoe afterwards when you have all these things rippling off it, you know. So it's affecting the bark, and then it also makes it brittle. Like I said earlier, the trees are dying, they're burning from the top down, and it makes the bark brittle. When we harvest bark, we just make an incision, you peel off the bark that you want. It's just the outside of the bark. Cambium here protects the tree. That the inner bark takes the tree, you see the little brown round around? That'll protect the tree, it doesn't dye anything. But when we take this off, that's where we check the pliability and all that to see how it is. when we remove that little piece of bark, we're not actually harming any trees. People, I go on the road a lot. I'm doing a lot of, I talk a lot about canoes and stuff. Because I enjoy sharing my culture with other people. It's making people aware of our culture and people know about us a little bit. I always thank Kevin Costner for bringing natives to the forefront, to be recognized as natives, with the movie Dancing with Wolves. At that time, when that came out, people started getting interested in our culture all of a sudden. I think what sparked that interest was, I think people are everybody's searching for something. And I think they thought maybe the natives have something else we didn't take yet. So they came to look for spirituality. Hmm. And that's what got the interest going, which is good for me. I got a lot of work giving demonstrations for canoes and everything, you know, because they invented the Aboriginal Day. We give us one day a year, you know, so then they want to show Aboriginal things. So I got hired, you know, I had to rent some Indians out once in a while to furnish the thing. And also, but it was all good. It's all good.
Well, we're all learning, and I'd say doing what we can to repair the damages of decisions past.
Yeah, but it's we're all together in here. You know, we have to work together. Dialogue helps. You know, talking with people that helps. You know, we find out that we're all the same. You know, we have to get along. We live together. We haven't got much of a choice at this point. You know, we're stuck together. But I think we should all try and get along so we can save the environment, so we can be around here for a little bit longer. You know, we need a lot of changes. If we would have had the mentality that my ancestors had of having respect for oneself and everything around them, today we would still have a good environment to live in, you know, and we can still have it. You know, we just have to back up a little bit and get back to the old ways and stuff, get back to the land and respect the land and have the land come back, because we need trees to survive. We need trees, we need water, we need air, we need everything, but the trees are a very important part of that, bringing back nature to its natural state. If we had respect for it, nature would heal itself and give it time. I have faith in that. I think we can do it. But we'd have to give it a global effort. It's not just a one-person thing or one nation. It's everybody's got to be realized that. So that's why I say educating people, showing that there could be ways that could be brought on, I think would help a lot, you know, and do that by sharing. This is good, I think. You know, talking about it a little bit.
For sure.
Not accusing anybody, admitting that we're all in denial and we're all guilty of what's going on, you know. So I think that would work it out.
It's I think you've hit that right on the nail there, that we all have played a role in getting us into this climate change difficulty, and we all have a role in getting out of it as well, or at least adapting to what the new environment is. That's fantastic. Maybe we'll take it. I'm looking forward to discussing with everybody in a little while. I'm going to
I never shut up, so just
we've got lots of wonderful things to say, but I'd love to have an opportunity to chat with Brenda and to hear a bit about her experiences as a traditional berry harvester. And so, Brenda, what can you tell us about yourself? Just start there.
Well, I first of all, I'd like to thank the National Capital Commission, the Urbanism Lab, for inviting me to, you know, to talk about my experiences growing up and witnessing the changes of climate change as it affects berry. I enjoy berry picking. It's one of my passions. I grew up in Kittigong, ZB, all my life. I used to go berry picking throughout the summer months with my mother and my siblings, and I appreciate the fact that even though we were raised in poverty, that we always managed to find our food sources and to have them, whether we are jamming them, canning them or whatever,
we always managed to have something to eat throughout the winter months, and it just, you know, it was something that we always look forward to. My mom used it all the time in her baking. I'm also glad that I'm sitting here beside Pinoc, because Pinoc is very knowledgeable in the things that he does, and I'm very proud of him. I look up to him. He's like one of my heroes in my community. I call him my community gem, because when I need to learn something, I go to Pinoc.
Mm-hmm. You know, wonderful.
Pinoc has taught me how to make birch bark canoes, and he's taught me how to make cradle boards. He's taught me how to make a hand drum. He's taught me how to make baskets. And like you said, you know, like, this is part of our culture. This is something that, you know, we need to learn, and we need to share with the new generations coming up. They need to know all about this stuff. They need to know who Pinoc is. They need to know who, you know, their grandmothers are, and their grandparents, and their aunties and uncles, because they're the ones that that had the experience that they had before me. And like Pinoc said, it's a lot about sharing, and that's part of our culture. We share, you know, we've shared amongst each other, we've traded amongst each other, we've traded berries amongst each other. No different than trading corn or trading tools for fishing or whatever. We traded food. And I thank the Urbanism Lab for inviting me to talk about berries. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, that's fantastic. And you've brought with you a few of your berry baskets. Is
yes.
that right? So yeah. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about them and okay. and the other things you've brought.
Well, traditionally, when we carried harvested berries, there are baskets such as birch bark baskets, and we have ashwood baskets. And, you know, this one, this design is made from artisans from the Manawan First Nations. And there's a depiction of the edge birch bark, and I have a depiction of berries. And I use this in my ceremonies, and when I feast, when I do my feasting ceremonies, I use birch bark baskets. So this is made by some ladies from my community. There are two sisters. Their names are Catherine and Kathleen Kay, and they've been making ashwood baskets for many years. And you know, they're also sharing their knowledge, and they teaching young people how to make beautiful baskets. And they have different designs other than this. And I've also wanted to share about some of the artwork that depicts berries. And this is a belt that belongs to my son. And of course, you know, it has floral motifs that that respect the woodland designs of our people. There are the blueberries that signify, you know, berries that he wanted on his traditional designs. He has his clan, the deer, on it. And so, yeah, this is just something that he's very proud of. And, you know, and it takes a lot of effort, I think, to showcase and be proud of something that talks about you as an individual. You know, this represents my son. And these represents, like, you know, our people. Our women use them. The women make them. Men too, they make them as well. And, you know, it's part of our culture. And thank you.
Thank you.
I hope everyone got a good glimpse.
I'm sure they did. And I know that you have a bit more to tell us about the stories of berries and how important they are to your culture.
Yeah, berries are very much important because they are part of the land. And, you know, that was something that our aunties and our grandmothers, our mothers did. It was their responsibility to pick up the berries, harvest the berries, clean the berries. And, you know, my dad would always say, you know, when you're out on the land and... And this was my first experience about land-based learning. It was that one one time we brought home a wild rabbit. Somebody gave our family a wild rabbit. The wild rabbit bunny was lost or couldn't find his mom, so we took the rabbit home. And I tried taking care of this little wild rabbit. You know, I fed him grapes, I fed him lettuce, and it just wouldn't respond to me. And so I had him in my box in the living room, and we had put holes in it so that he'd sleep at night. And I asked my dad, I said, "Dad," I said, "the rabbit doesn't want to eat. He doesn't want to respond to me." And he sat in his chair and he looked at me and he says, "Donis, you know, daughter," he says, "he's not going to listen to you." And I said, "Why is that?" He says, "Because he don't speak English. He speaks Anishinaabemowin." And he says, "Watch this." So he started talking to the rabbit in Algonquin. And the rabbit stood up, put his paws on the box, you know, and he started, you know, moving his ears and his head, and he seemed very happy. And then my dad said, "See," he says, "you have to talk to them in our language." That's one thing I first learned. And, you know, and that's one thing that I think our people, you know, when they're doing land-based learning, education, you know, is learning the language, especially the young ones, you know, to really, you know, like Pinocchio spoke about respect, you know, and when we start talking about respect, you know, start teaching them really young about respect, you know, like, for example, talking to the little bunnies, you know, the deer, you know, and let them experience that sensation, that moment where, you know, the animal will look at you and not be afraid of you because you're talking to them in your language.
You're bringing me to memories of walking through the forest and coming across a deer and simply being in communion with that deer.
Mm-hmm.
Just look at one another, and I've been in awe of its presence, and it just seems to be taking me in. And it's a really magical moment when you can connect with the natural world in that way.
It is for me, because and for my family as well, because we have this this alliedship, this interconnectedness with the our guardians. And so we have guardianships with the deer, for example, and, you know, for the eagle, or could be the bear. And you know, just feasting them with tools like this, you know, you become friends with them, and that becomes part of your identity, your culture. And you know, those are the teachings that I've learned throughout the years, and that, you know, it's all interconnected with the land and spirit, language, and you know, respect is a big thing, a very big thing.
Well, I know you in your text you have a bit about the Ashnib Anishinaabemowin.
Mm-hmm.
Did I say that correctly?
Yes.
Words for the different kinds of berries, and I, you know, I tell us more about that. I mean,
Well, we have a variety of berries. You know, we have a ditagagumin, which is a blackberry. We have odeamin, which is the strawberry. We have mean or meanin, the blueberries. And then we have mushkigamin, are the low cranberries. So we have a variety of berries that we harvest in our area. And it's not only humans that harvest those berries, it's the wildlife as well. And I've seen crows eat the choke cherries off the trees in my yard, you know. And so, I mean, the wildlife, even to the squirrel, will eat the berries. And so we have to respect the berry. We have to respect the berry patches. We have to leave some for them, and because they got to eat. You know, it's easy for us to go to the store, buy our food, buy a bologna or whatever, and, you know, buy dessert. But we always have to leave something for the animals. at any season.
Yeah, that's very important. What are some of the spiritual essence around the berries, and what can you tell us about that?
Well, from my own teachings and
from my own experience, is that well, of course, it's an important food source, but it's more than that. We use berries to connect with the spirit world. We provide our offerings, and we send them off. We send our feast baskets with our tobacco. It's part of our tradition, you know, that's our culture. That's my my tradition. That's me. That's me connecting to my guardianship. I make that friendship, and I carry that with me throughout my walk of life until that ends, you know. And I respect that. I have all my faith in that. It's my belief system, and you know, that's something that I do every day. That's something that I take serious in my life. I carry that with me. Yeah.
Well, given that our talk tonight is around climate change, mm-hmm. what are some of the things that you're seeing in your collection of berries that seem to be affected by climate?
Sure. Well, I know, trees have been cut down, and trees are cut down everywhere. And through my experience, we used to plant trees. And we used to plant softwood trees because they're the fastest growing trees. We used to plant like pine and balsam and spruce. And when you're planting trees, which is okay and stuff like that, but you know, if you're going to cover up berry patches, that's the natural berry patch. And you're affecting the soil, you're pushing the soil back, you're trying to burn stuff, and that affects everything. That affects the soil, it affects wildlife in particular. And I think it's just there's some sadness to see that, you know, climate change has affected something as simple as berry picking, you know, something that we've done for many, many, many years. And, the wildlife need it. The wildlife depend on it. Mm-hmm. You know, something as big as a bear down to a squirrel, down to a bird. They love berries, you know. I've seen them eat berries, and I think we got to be more mindful of the animal life. Yeah.
For sure. How are you sharing your berry collection techniques and so on, and knowledge of the berry patches with the youth of your community?
Well, I've always started with family first, you know, because you got to start with family, you know. You got to go out, get up early in the morning, and you got to go pick berries, you know, and, you got to teach them how to clean them, and if you want to store them or freeze them, if you want to make jams and jellies. And I think there's already like land-based learning already happening in our communities. And I think, by connecting to the earth and understanding the happenings of climate change, I think young people are learning to be botanists, and they're learning to garden, including like vegetable gardening and stuff like that. They're also learning at the schools, and but I always felt that there has to be something. For me, there was always this connectedness with the spirit, you know, because when I'm making offerings or whatever, you know, I always felt like I'm making my true connection with my guardians. And when I see, you know, the effects of climate change and the, you know, the trees being cut and the trees, you know, the erosion of the earth and whatever, I feel like the sciences destroys like my being, as you know, as the way like I practice my belief system. It's no different than a child being taken from their parent and sent to residential school, you know, and it's to express that, and it's to, and to share that knowledge, share that experience from a person, say, listen, this is how I feel, you know. And I think we have to start really teaching them young, taking them out onto the land, because they can observe. They can observe the landscape. You know, young kids will observe the landscape when it's nature's in abundance. They'll observe it when there's, you know, cuts of wood. Like, they'll ask questions, you know. I think if we start young enough, like Pinoc said, we can, you know, we can, you know, try and heal the earth, heal ourselves. And we're all in it together.
We are indeed all in it together. Brenda, thank you so much for sharing about your knowledge of the berries and of those traditional techniques, and the respect that's inherent in your way of walking softly on the earth.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Which. I'd love to invite Brett and Ian back into the conversation with us. I think this is probably a good time for that. We have a few questions sort of prepared, but I also want to speak to the audience out there and say, if you have questions for our audience, for our panelists tonight, please don't hesitate to put your questions into the YouTube chat. N'hésitez pas à mettre vos questions dans le chat pour le YouTube. Et nous allons transmettre vos questions pour alimenter la discussion ce soir. So we'll bring those questions in. Okay, so one of the things that from Brett and Ian's presentation that was very profound was that notion of two-eyed seeing, and I maybe you could expand a little bit more on that concept, Brett or Ian, and I'd be curious to hear how Pinoc and Brenda, how that concept resonates with you as well. So maybe I'll start with you, Brett and Ian, and we'll come back to the stage afterwards.
Certainly. Well, I just wanted to kind of begin by, you know, again, prefacing with the teachings that Elder Albert Marshall and his wife had incorporated into the two-eyed seeing methodology, come from their nation, but a lot of the process in developing the paper around two-eyed seeing brought out a lot of the lessons learned through their development process. And in those lessons learned, I would argue if any Indigenous person who speaks their language were to read through that list of lessons learned, the methods in which you approach two-eyed seeing, there's a word in our languages for each of those lessons learned, and there are anything from the pedagogy of your nation, like how your people would teach about the land, and the respect that you had to have for the land itself before you were to learn from it, but also understanding how the way that you approach developing a relationship. And that was key in that two-eyed seeing, was that creation of relationships between two peoples. And that's something that was done with the nations on these territories for thousands of years. Many of them would come together and connect, and their leaders would connect, their matrix would connect, and they would create relationships that would mutually benefit each nation. Now, whether it be through that trade or whether it be through sharing resources on a particular area. So those are the things that kind of come, those ways of knowing are what they incorporated into the two-eyed seeing methodology. And Elder Albert Marshall does a really great job of explaining that. And we will also have that video that he, of his presentation with us, we'll be posting as well. So people can actually see that. We'll have it up on the Climate Atlas as soon as it's the video is done editing. But it is really phenomenal to kind of listen to him talk about that. And, but yeah, the key component to that is creating those relationships.
And I might jump in there. I want to thank Brendan Pinnock, the stories, the knowledge, the generosity. You know, it'd be great if we could be there with you. It's wonderful to be in this virtual world with you today, regardless. As a settler, you know, as a trained scientist, you know, this two-eyed seeing is a portal in, but it's also something that has to be done very carefully. And so I've been interviewed about it, you know, on the kind of Western side, the one eye. And, you know, I often will say that, you know, people will talk about integrating knowledge. And for me, you know, integration is a fabulous and very dangerous word, in that, you know, we can come together and soar on both wings and find a kind of flight that's built on reciprocity and respect and all those good things that Brett is mentioning and we've all been talking about. But integration can also be lopsided, and it's in many ways, you know, can be assimilation. And we have to be very careful that when we're doing this bridging work, as Brett said, that respect, that careful relationship building is done in a very thoughtful way. And again, back to ceremony, we do things in a certain way with a certain protocol, following the guidance of elders and knowledge keepers, to make sure the things that we do are grounded in the right kinds of ways, and power dynamics don't creep into these things and create these asymmetries in knowledge, so that, you know, one eye is stronger than the other and there's a difference in the kind of balance of how we see the world. And so it really is a powerful way of doing things, but one that has to be done very, very carefully. And for someone like myself, you know, that does kind of drive how I work at that, is just being careful, cautious, walking lightly, building relationships in a good way. So I'll leave it at that.
Does that notion of two-eyed seeing, does that have some resonance with you?
That sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah,
because we need to all talk to each other, you know, and so to get both sides of the thing. So it's two-eyed, makes a good sense to me. Yeah. Yeah, so I like that idea.
I'm grooving on it as well. How about you, Brenda?
Sure, it does. I think the principle does resonate. You know, everybody talks about respect and looking at different worldviews. The key is communication, and whether we're looking at Western science or traditional science and practices, I think a lot of conversations have to be made around that.
Yeah. So back to you, Ian and Brett, what is part of that methodology, and how can we all apply that in our approaches to climate change and perhaps other challenges that are facing our world?
Well, I always think about, you know, I've come from a nation that didn't make contact until 1856. So we were very fortunate to retain a lot of our inherent knowledges, and you know, we still use our traditional governance systems, and we have a matrilineal society, and the matriarchs still lead our peoples. And so for me, that connection to our knowledge from the past, the experiences that we have gone through the glacial maximums that have happened on in North America, what people often refer to as the Ice Age. We've had a city that existed on at least three of those instances. And the knowledge that we have of those changes, the climactic change that happens normally over thousands of years, might help us adapt into this accelerated predicament we're in now caused by human activity. And I think understanding the knowledge systems themselves and realizing that there's many truths of the world in what people call mythologies. There, you know, we talk about our creation stories here, you know, talking about the blue jay as being one who showed the man fire. Well, what we mean by that is we've watched blue jays who will actually take sticks that are on fire and spread it to another forest to build more fire. And in essence, they are seeing their food come flying out, all the other insects and bugs come out of the forest when it's on fire. They unknowingly create new replenished soil while they're trying to get a free meal for themselves. And this is something that if you look in Australia, the Aborigine people have documented how they see the birds using fire to chase out their food as well. So these are things that come from our knowledge systems. And each of the people who carry these knowledge systems carry the stories from their people. When we keep sharing these stories, that's how we learn from them. So each of the stories come with lessons about not misusing your resources, not treating things in a very negative way so that you can continually have access to them. So these are the types of things that we want to access. And this is one method of accessing that, is to create a relationship so that we can help decipher the stories and bring it, connect it to the research that's out there, so that the research can also become better itself. And that's what two-eyed seeing in essence really is taking these amazing knowledge systems that have survived the peoples here for thousands of years and helping bring it into research so that the research can actually start evolving itself. Now, Ian, I don't know if you want to add more to that.
I've been working with Brett for a long time, and we've done many of these presentations, and you continue to blow me away, Brett, just the things that you kind of come up with. And I think that kind of humility, right? Just knowing that, you know, there is another way of knowing the world, and sitting back and allowing that to take the forefront. And Brett, you know, it's just always amazing to do these presentations with you. And so I think, you know, again, as someone who's not from, you know, an Indigenous culture, I think I agree with everything that Brett is saying, but I want to just kind of say, we have to be careful. Like right now, you know, with reconciliation and all these things, all the buzzwords, and reconciliation isn't a buzzword, but when people use it like that, you know, and Indigenous knowledge, and oh yeah, Indigenous knowledge is incorporated in all these things, it can be really done in a disingenuous way. And right now in this country, there's a national adaptation strategy that's being developed. There's a huge amount of attention on the importance of Indigenous knowledge, you know, in redefining, you know, our relationship with the natural world as we try and figure out the climate crisis. And it is a crisis in a very real way. And the knowledge of Indigenous peoples is absolutely critical to figuring out how to navigate this, but it cannot be done in some sort of tokenistic way. So everybody's saying the right things right now. Everybody's saying, you know, two-eyed seeing, let's do it together. Let's be in partnership. But if it's only words and it's not action, and if, you know, there's not a commitment to really following that knowledge that Brett and others here have been talking about today, you know, we risk kind of repeating the mistakes of the past. And we don't have time for that when we talk about climate change. We really do need to reset the way we do business and the way we act with each other and interact with the land. And so, you know, again, when maybe people who are listening or those policymakers are out there, this isn't lip service. This is a real different way of doing things and a different way of having relationships. And I think the climate crisis is a perfect opportunity for us to be guided by Indigenous knowledge. And Indigenous knowledge is the cosmology and the understanding of how the universe fits together. Science is like a, you know, as Carl Sagan said, it's like a flashlight in the dark. It points over here and it points over there and it illuminates things and it helps us understand things in a really high kind of resolution way, but we miss the big picture often. And that's where Indigenous knowledge can guide science in a very real way, not in a tokenistic way, but in a true sense of partnership, and they do different things in different ways, and that's where I think the real opportunity is.
Yeah, for sure. And one of the things that I was really struck by in your presentation, Ian, was around that progression of, or that identification of values and how those have led to behaviors and how those have led to effects such as climate change. How do we kind of go the other way and change behaviors and change values to bring about positive change in our society and our world?
Well, we helped Elder Kershane and the elders and knowledge keepers at Turtle Lodge write that up. But those were Indigenous perspectives, right? And so I'd almost kind of defer to the larger group here, you know, around how the Indigenous values can, you know, infuse and take hold and change, you know, that colonial taproot that has been, you know, in a way brought into all of our minds, and how do we kind of push that out and find a different way? I think that's critical, right? It's not just climate change, it's us, it's our values, and I'm not the expert here, right? I would defer to the larger panel here around that, because I think that's something that is really better positioned for some of the other speakers.
Sure thing. I think you're wise to say that, to defer to our other panelists. What would you say, Pinocchio, in terms of changing our values so that we can overcome or mitigate if climate change and another negative environmental effects?
I totally agree with what they're talking about. I think we should all share what knowledge do we do have, and through dialogue, we can come up with something that we can offer to society to change the climate change that we're worried about right now, because the native way of doing things was very simple, but straightforward and very useful, practical, but it taught things out really well. So maybe it's coming back, that would help us all. I don't, I always believe in educating people. So if we've shared things and come up with something good to share, we can start convincing people to think in a certain way, but we'd have to all work together in order to achieve that. And I think the best way, like what we're doing today, like dialogue, talking a little bit, exchange a few ideas, it's just, I think we'd have come a long way. We did go a long way with that, I think.
How would you address that question of values and how we could reorient our values?
I think I'd like to take it one step further. I think that it was said that you're looking at Indigenous knowledge to assist scientific work to to deter climate change and to bring out the knowledge of and shared. Sharing and all that. I think that to me, it's like science leading everybody. And I don't believe in that approach because of my belief system. I believe that in the things that I was raised with and the legends and stories that was taught to us we're not even being listened to in the way that we should be. Science isn't listening to us, really, because the way I see it is like their method is better than ours, in my sense. That's just my own personal opinion. And for me, it's like this, Western science doesn't get it. because, and I've said it before, it's like when you take away something from the earth or from the animals, the humans, you know, because the human, the wildlife, according to our creation story, the wildlife and what you see around the earth are the first Anishinaabe people. And for me, it's like, we still haven't been listened to as Anishinaabe people. And it's like cutting us off, disconnecting, just trying to disconnect us from expressing as who we are. And I feel that, it's like a disconnecting from our allyship with our guardians. You know, we have guardians. My son has a guardian, you know, I have a guardian, you know, my family have guardians. And, it takes away from understanding the creator. I think that would be the bottom line for me. And Western science, I don't think, hasn't gotten it yet.
That's a major allegation, and one that needs a lot of introspection and examination. Brett, did you have anything you wanted to say? And I also want to be sure that we take the opportunity to introduce any questions that have come from the public, if there are any. I'm seeing not so much, but we've got lots of things to talk about. Nevertheless, so
I'm just thinking with respect to that statement, it is important to understand that where we're coming from with regards to that. I go back to the early 1900s here when commercial fisheries first started happening in British Columbia. And we had been telling the Department of Fisheries that the salmon and the different species on the river feed the land, and that all of the land is created by the salmon. And they just told us that was absurd. There's plenty of fish here. We'll just keep fishing it. And we explained to them that we knew that all the trees were connected, that when a salmon is eaten by wildlife, they don't eat the whole thing. They leave most of it. They only eat the fatty parts to nourish themselves and the rest of it to decompose in the forest. And, you know, we explained that. And I think actually National Geographic had an article about a notebook from one of the Department of Fisheries officers who actually wrote this down from the Indigenous people they were talking to in Southern BC. So we had been talking to the fisheries about this for a long time. And it wasn't, I would say, probably in the 90s that they finally started to actually look at the impacts that the salmon had on the ecosystem. Then they realized they started measuring N15, which is a marine-derived nitrogen, and all over the land, as far in as Alberta. And they started measuring this by looking at the feathers that are coming off of the birds and the fur that was coming off the grizzlies. They would see that a grizzly, you know, when it's coming out of hibernation, was still receiving N15. They didn't know why until they realized that the grasses that they were eating coming out of hibernation contained N15. And you can actually correlate that to the growth rings on the trees and how the status of the salmon population will show in the measurement of the rings, how fast the tree was growing at a particular time when the salmon was plentiful. And there are trees in existence right now where you can go back to when the commercial fishery started up until now, and you can watch that tree slowing its growth because it's not getting as much nutrients anymore. So this is an example of how science was not listening. The science was there by defined by us through our culture and our histories long before it ever became studied in the Western format. And we had people telling us to our face that we didn't know anything because we didn't follow their methodologies. So the reason I started working with Dr. Morrow and his team is because they didn't look at me this way. they looked at me as another form of information to include in the research. And that's the way science should be. Anything is peer reviewable. It's farcical to say that you have to follow one singular mode of transportation. You know, there's amazing methods that come from a pluriverse of perspectives in this world. And I think changing it is not going to hurt science. Changing how we do things is not going to hurt what research has done. In fact, all of the greatest things you can accomplish in through scientific research has happened through imagination and going outside of the. I mean, look at Albert Einstein. He said imagination is more important than knowledge. So when you include these different forms of information together, your imagination grows. Your ability to see beyond what's in front of you grows. And this is what spirituality is about in our nations. Spirituality is about connecting to a different perspective, to see the world for what it is and not for what you just see in front of you. So this is where cultural connection is important for our peoples. And each people carry their own creations. Each people carry their own vital histories. And we can't deny any of them, because that is how they grew up in their world. That is how they were formed. And that is how they were created. So this will enrich where we go in the future. And that's part of what we want to do. And I just wanted to kind of, I'm running along just because I wanted to fit as much as I could in. I do have to take off because I am emceeing my auntie, who is a chief. I'm emceeing her celebration of life and ceremony. So I do have to go represent her and all of her spirit and everything that she was and she taught me, because I learned from all of them. So this is something that I wanted to impart on you. And I really thank you for all of your time and your ears. And I appreciate listening to your stories. You guys are phenomenal on stage there. Your information is vital. And never stop sharing that information that you have, because it is going to be important for our children and your grandchildren and my grandchildren to learn the many different informations that we have in this world coming from the different people. But yes, again, thank you so much from my heart to yours. And thank you for your time and giving me the honor of speaking with all of you. I'd like to say Hagolian, and so we say walk softly. Again, it's the same teachings, just in different words. And thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Merci, Miigwech. And we wish you and your family the very best in this time of celebration of life, but also of grieving. So we send you off into your evening. Thanks, Brett. Wow. It's hard to follow that. Brett is extremely eloquent. Takes the words away, actually. But as we sort of bring our session to a close, I wanted to give each of us an opportunity to share, you know, sort of a final word of wisdom around climate change and how we can sort of turn things around so that we all can continue to walk softly on Mother Earth and live harmoniously on this planet. Who shall I start with? Ian, do you want to start?
Sure. I think it's fitting for our knowledge keepers on the stage to kind of end the session, so I'm happy to go. When you asked that question and just seeing Brett in his Gitxsan territory there, it brings me to think about filming beyond climate. So we filmed across British Columbia, interacting with First Nations communities all over the place. And we were kind of on the hunt for salmon. We were trying to understand the salmon story, because salmon are temperature sensitive. And so with climate change, it has a huge impact on salmon species and a lot of different fish species. And we kept kind of missing these kind of salmon stories. And we were leaving British Columbia from the Northern Highway at Valemont, at Mount Robson, which is the highest mountain in the Canadian Rockies. And we met this old woman in a bakery after we had kind of filmed the mountains. And she was telling us these stories. She was a non-Indigenous woman, but she was in her 80s. And she said, oh, you're making a movie, you're doing all this stuff. Well, you should come to my house and we should talk. And we were going to leave. And my cameraman was like, you're going to make me do another interview, aren't you? You know, and it was just like, we're finished. I thought we were finished. And she took us to her house and we were literally, you can see it at the end of the film, we're plugging cameras together and cables. And she came out in a walker and she's like literally cooking in this walker and she's moving. And we don't realize that we're on the turn of a river. Her property is right on a river and it's actually a tributary of the Fraser. So where the Pacific meets the kind of land and the Fraser comes in, that river goes all the way up into tributaries to the Rocky Mountains. All the way to the Rockies. And we're right there. And this woman's cooking in her walker. And she's saying, you got to come with me. And we're putting all this stuff together. And we start filming. And she's like, every day, you know, on this day in August, the salmon returned. And all of a sudden, we were there and we're filming. And these salmon are in the river and they're swimming. And it was just mind-blowing that these salmon had swum all the way from the ocean to the Rocky Mountains. And it always makes me think, you know, that if salmon can do that, you know, we can certainly dig deep as human beings to try and solve climate change. You know, nature is so inspiring and it demonstrates to us that there are so much, there's so much potential to overcome adversity and actually figure this out. And nature is a model for that. And I'll leave it at that.
Wonderful. Brenda, what would be your sort of closing words of wisdom in terms of climate change and how we live softly on the earth?
Well, I think you know, if we're going to look at the words walk softly on Mother Earth, you know, like we've always used that term, you know, when we dance to our songs and whatever. And but when we're looking at climate change and like that, I think we have to take small steps and take action, be responsible to your surroundings. You don't have to go and find major solutions. You know, you can do the most simplest thing. And I was always taught to put your tobacco down on the earth, under a tree, in the water, and say thank you. It's the most simple message, you know, between you and the spirit, and say thank you, because the spirits are all over the earth. They're in the heavens. And you know, if you know, maybe they'd want to give offerings of berries, but something that I've always done. But you know, it's always these little steps can take you to something else. I've always believed in listening to our people, you know, sharing our stories, and then listening to our young people. I think that's important as well. I think you know, we tend to like disregard them because the but I think they have dreams and I think they have visions and I think we have to listen to them as well.
Luke, I think you may have the last word on this.
Really? I don't know. I kind of envy my ancestors for the mentality that they had, keeping it simple and realizing that they're only part of the balance of nature. So they kept respectfully taking care of the other part of nature as well, by not taking what they wanted, but just what they needed. Using the nature, but not abusing it, you know, so that they kept a healthy environment at all times. It wasn't just it was their way of life, you know, a respectful life. That's the most important thing that we lost. I feel that's the most important thing of all the things that we lost in our culture is down to that one word, it's respect. You know, everything would fall into place if we can get that back again. So if we're able to teach people, you know, we can unlock our doors again and, you know, live peacefully. And I think that would make a change in the environmental issues as well, you know, because we'd be polluting less. You know, we wouldn't be such a throwaway society. We'd kind of keep things, you know, that last for a while. Go back to the old ways of where things were repairable and we can keep them for a long time instead of today. We, as soon as your guarantee runs out, your machine is pretty well done, you know, and we do things, we do everything to go for the economic things. It's always the mighty dollar that's monitoring everything, you know, we're not thinking very sensibly in that state, you know, because it's always economics, You know, money is the main thing that it's a good motivator, but not necessarily a healthy motivator, you know. So I think if we should go back to the simple things in life, you know, and try and get some respect back, I think that would kind of help. But I'm just saying this as a person, that's my own opinion. I do not want you to say that's the Algonquin way of thinking. I'm not representing the Algonquins, and I'm not representing Kitigan ZB either. I'm just speaking from myself, you know, because I don't want people to say, well, that's the way those people think, and that's the way Pinot thinks.
That's an important distinction. You are your own individual, and I certainly take your comments as being yours. They're personal ones, not
less people.
Okay.
Thinking safe.
Wow.
But I really appreciate being invited here. You know, I think it was a very good evening.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, I know it's been a really rich conversation. I think our 2 hours has gone by really, really quickly. That's certainly how it feels. We've had a really rich conversation, and in those closing comments, hearing about, you know, the sort of the tenacity of the salmon and drawing lessons from that, saying thank you to the earth and to the spirits, and to have respect for the planet and for each other. Those are really important values that and actions that we can take to counteract some of the negative things that we're seeing in the world. Ian, Pinot, Brenda, Brett, thank you so very much for being with us tonight in the Urbanism Lab. Thank you very much to our audience for being with us tonight. Thank you to all of the crew. You on YouTube don't see, but we've got a number of people here in the lab and offsite who are making things possible tonight. It's really been a delight to host this evening and to learn so much from our esteemed guests. Pardon me. This is the last Urbanism Lab of season 8. Over the course of the summer, we'll be working hard on our programming for season 9, and we hope to be back in the lab in a physical format, because it's been a couple of years of virtual and this first hybrid one that we've done tonight, which I hope, from the audience perspective, has been a success. So, in closing, thank you very much to all of you. Merci beaucoup. Bonne soirée. Je vous souhaite une très belle soirée. Goodbye.